I feel a little Oprah, like, let's talk about sex. But that is the name of the panel.
Who are you guys?
Oh, I get there. Don't worry, I'll get there.
Isn't that the question?
I'll get there. Before we talk about sex.
The question is, who the fuck are you?
Yeah, exactly.
Just kidding. We will introduce ourselves.
All right, to my left. Well, first, I'm Hanna Rosin. Hi. The three of us, we've been talking about sex a lot today. I'm Hanna Rosin. I'm the host of an NPR show called Invisibilia about human behavior. Thank you. It's a great show. In the middle of its second season right now. To my left is the fabulous Esther Perel. Yeah, apparently everyone else knows. Esther Perel, who's a psychotherapist and writer in New York. She's an author of the bestseller Mating in Captivity, an upcoming book about infidelity, which I know a lot about, which is going to be great. Not, I don't know a lot about infidelity. I know a lot about her book about infidelity. Sorry, David.
Young.
And she has given several TED Talks. They've been viewed more than 13 million times by people all over the world. She's a consultant on the show The Affair, which is a fabulous show. Fabulous show. And finally, she's a new columnist at Cosmo. So you can read her words of wisdom there. To her left, hi, is Dan Savage.
Oh, sorry. I had a thing in my head.
You know, you have to mix it up. He writes the sex advice column Savage Love, which has been a hit for 25 years.
Oh my God.
25 years. He hosts the podcast Savage Lovecast, also a hit. And he started the It Gets Better project. This is where you should really applause. To help prevent suicide among LGBTQ youth. And, you know, he's got his own, everyone on the stage, I realize, except me, has TV cred. Because Dan was on Sex Box. Raise your hand if you've seen Sex Box, the weirdest show ever on television, where two people go into a box and have sex, and then the judges judge it. That is an actual television show, which I haven't yet in any of our panels made Dan talk about. And maybe today will be the day.
You should be doing that.
And Jennifer, before you start laughing, we'll get to your television fame in a minute. Jennifer Finney Boylan, trans activist and an author. She writes columns for the New York Times about LGBTQ rights, about politics. She's written 13 books, including her autobiography. She's Not There, A Life in Two Genders. Esther is clapping because she recently had a writer's block. So she's thinking 13 books. Yeah. That's 52 years worth of writing. Which was the first book by an openly transgender American to become a bestseller. She's a writer in residence at Barnard College, Columbia, and she appears in, drumroll, I Am Cait.
I mean, yay.
The reality show about Caitlyn Jenner as the voice of reason. That's how she's described in the press.
Voice of reason.
Which means that she yells at Caitlyn about being a Republican. That's what voice of reason means in this particular context. She's also chair of the board of GLAAD, which is more respectable. Yes. Okay. So I actually want to start. No whispering. You have to share. Get a room, exactly. Okay.
Get a box.
Why don't we just go straight to Sex Box? Forget my question. Give us 5 minutes on Sex Box, and then I'll start my question.
I'll give you 30 seconds on Sex Box. It was a show produced by Channel 4 in Britain. And they had a panel of psychotherapists, me, who's an unqualified jackass, but I take questions, and another sex writer, Shrink, and we would talk to the couple about their sex lives, about their issues, about who they were, and then they would go in this box and fuck while we continued to talk about them in their absence. And then they would come out and we would talk about the fucking they just fucked in the fuck box. And it was a very weird show that then came to America. I was not in the American version. I was just in the British one-off special. Uh-huh. And people were traumatized because you were seeing this thing. You were looking at this box. You couldn't see through the walls or anything. They weren't.
Why did they do sound effects?
There was no sound effects. It was soundproof. But people were freaked out because there was somebody in that shot behind that wall. But anybody's ever seen an establishing shot of New York City in a film. There were people fucking in those buildings when that helicopter went over the city at night filming. So it really was nothing new, but people freaked the fuck out. Sex box. Now let's move on.
Now let's start our conversation. Before we start, you guys are part of this evening in this way. You've received cards. Yes? People have handed out cards. Here's what those cards are for. You have before you a sex box quality panel of advice experts. You are now going to write down the sex questions that you have always been too afraid to ask. Okay? They can be about your friend. They're all about your friend. We'll just assume they're about your friend, okay? I don't care who you are, they're entirely anonymous, but you would be wasting a precious opportunity if you did not ask tonight the question that you have always wanted to ask. It can be about infidelity, marriage, anal sex, anything you want to ask, please ask it now. Then we're going to look over the questions, and these guys are going to answer them.
Yes, okay? I can have an orgasm.
What?
Yes, I can have an orgasm.
Don't ask these guys stupid personal questions about their lives based on what you read on Twitter. Don't do that. That's not what the questions are for. Don't turn the camera. You are looking in the mirror. These questions are about you, not about these guys on the stage. So get going. Why are you looking at me? I want your brains working. I want you to start thinking. Oh, they've already been collected. Okay, so let's start. We're going to start where we've been having a lot of talks about sex here at Aspen. I'm going to start where these talks left off. Both Esther and Dan have dangled the possibility of a new kind of marriage arrangement, of a solution to the problem of monogamy, that is to say that you have to have sex with the same person for the rest of your life. Universal problem. So they've both kind of hinted that we're headed towards a different future where the boring heteronormative marriage, such as my own and many of yours, is only one solution in a possible exciting future, which will be available to boring people and evangelical Christians. But apparently there's going to be lots of other options. So I want you guys to talk about that. I will start with you, Dan. I know you probably flipped a coin, but I'm making you do it first. What has gay marriage taught us boring people about these various rainbow of possibilities?
Oh, my God. Well, gay couples, traditional gay couples, monogamy was a conversation, and a monogamous commitment was an opt-in arrangement. It wasn't a default setting. So gay couples would have these conversations about whether or not they were going to be monogamous. And some gay couples, a minority of gay male couples, actually are monogamous or claim they're monogamous, just as a large majority of couples who say they're monogamous are not monogamous. Some people think they're in a monogamous relationship, and they're not.
Statistically a measured minority?
Yes.
Is that true?
Yes.
Okay.
The difference between many, or most gay non-monogamous couples and straight non-monogamous couples is gay non-monogamous couples are usually being honest about it with each other, both know they're in a non-monogamous relationship, and are often open about it with their friends and sometimes even with their families and neighbors and social circles. They're open about it. And that is a new and different kind of marital arrangement. I know when Obergefell was passed, you wrote a piece, I think, for Slate on most gay couples aren't monogamous, and what does this mean that we're putting non-monogamy at the heart of marriage? At a tiny percentage of marriages between same-sex male couples. And what it means, and I would think it's an example of something healthier, that it should be a conversation, it should be an option. Maybe it's the option that most will choose, but one of the problems with monogamy in straight relationships is that people enter into it whether or not they're suited for it. And if it's treated as a default setting and you're not good at it...
What does that mean, suited for it?
Whether
does that mean what you want? Or does that mean...
Whether you can do it or not. And not everyone can do it. And we need to have a smarter conversation about monogamy and what it means. Literally, monogamy is the only thing that humans undertake that we regard 100% perfection, perfect execution, as the baseline. You can be a really great snowboarder and fall down and get up and still be a great snowboarder. And you can be the world's greatest chef and burn a fucking omelet. But if you're monogamous and you fuck somebody else twice or once, you were terrible at monogamy. You were bad at it. You failed at it. You should be divorced because you fucked that up. And we talk about monogamy. Straight people do. Poor dears. You talk about monogamy the way you talk about virginity, as if you have this monogamy hymen and you have sex with somebody else and you popped it and it's gone. And we should talk, if we want our relationships to survive long term, we should talk about monogamy the way we talk about sobriety. You're sober and you fell off the wagon, but you can sober the fuck back up. You can monogamous back up.
You know what? You talk about non-monogamy like it's nothing. You talk about non-monogamy like it's like a real estate contract. Like, you just sit down and you're like, that's fine, I'll do this. Yeah, I'll do the dishes,
well,
and you take out the garbage.
It's a fraught conversation. It's a fraught conversation, and it's going to have different emotional components depending on the couple that's having the negotiation and having the conversation about it. The problem is that it's a default setting. And the problem is that we have traded, or we substitute monogamy, or symbolically, it is a measure of how much you love each other, whether you're doing this thing well. And so we know from infidelity statistics that infidelity is going to touch almost every long-term committed relationship. So if we say monogamy, a non-monogamous moment, an adultery, an infidelity is the ultimate betrayal, we will experience it as the ultimate betrayal. If we say it's unforgivable, we will not be able to forgive it. And so in a way, because of how we have placed monogamy, we have written the death warrants for our marriages before we even get to the altar, which is crazy. We should judge infidelities on a case-by-case basis. Fucked your sister on your wedding night, probably can't get past that. 30 years into a marriage?
That's the bar?
Well, just giving an example. I'm giving an example. 30 years into a marriage, she slept with the personal trainer once, or he got a hand job on a business trip. Maybe that can be endured and gotten past because everything else the marriage is about is more important and should be given more weight. I'm the one, and I'll finish because other people will talk. I'm the one who's often accused of placing too much emphasis on sex by people who then turn around and say, adultery is unforgivable and the answer is always divorce. So I say, look at this marriage and put on the scales. On one side, there's children, property, history, intimacy, two extended families knit together, position in the community. There's all these things on one side, and you're going to put blowjob on the other side, and it outweighs all of that. And I'm saying, and I'm the one who puts too much emphasis on sex, maybe the blowjob should have less weight than all the rest of this stuff.
I thought it was a hand job. I mean, now that
or
it's
a hand
blowjob.
A job involving genitals, and we shouldn't make them male genitals because it's not just men who cheat.
Right. Okay, Esther, I know that you don't believe a single infidelity means the death of a marriage or the destruction of anything, but do you think that Dan's view is a particularly gay dude view, or is it extrapolatable to other marriages?
So, hello, everyone. Okay, let me deconstruct this for a minute. First of all, I think that a conversation between two men is a much more equal power conversation than a conversation between men and women. For most of history, monogamy was basically an imposition on women by patriarchy in order to know whose children these are and who will get the cows when I die. It was about patrimony and lineage. It had zero to do with love. And by the way, by definition, there are all kinds of evolutionary and biological theories that come to support why men have a natural need to roam, and women don't. Women are kind of naturally domesticated creatures who don't need to go anywhere. Which always makes me wonder why is she then locked up everywhere. But The subject of monogamy has never been an equal subject. It was monogamy for women until contraception. And then women began to change the entire playing field. So monogamy had nothing to do with love. Now it has everything to do with love because people used to marry and have sex for the first time, and now they marry and they stop having sex with others. And monogamy used to be one person for life, and now monogamy is one person at a time. And everyone goes around saying, I am monogamous in every relationship. You know, and it makes perfect sense. You know, and besides, we have not been monogamous before, we tied the knot, so that at this point, we are not monogamous in our fantasies for sure. We're not monogamous in our memories either. So we are only left with reality, and reality is a rather small portion of our consciousness. So, you know, That's and then monogamy, where are we talking about? Where does sex start? I mean, are we talking about, you know, this is a continuum. This is a very, this notion that it's just a fuck or another fuck or a blowjob, another blowjob. I mean, seriously, sexuality happens in many, many parts of ourselves that have nothing to do with genitals. But it is true that in many straight relationships, the only conversation about monogamy goes like this. I catch you, you're dead. That's the extent of the chat. And why is this so short? Because romanticism, the romantic ideal, has really, which is one of the most tenacious ideologies of today, has made it so that when I find you, you, the one, how am I going to then talk with you about my attractions, my interest with the others that I haven't chosen? What are we to do with what I like to call the shadow of the third? You know, you can't have this conversation since you're the one that is meant to meet all my needs. So most straight couples would have this conversation only after the shit hits the fan, when they're in a state of crisis, when there has been a betrayal, a deception, a lying, a secrecy, a breach of trust, all of that. Unfortunately, and that, you're absolutely right, gay couples, the conversation is not assumed, it's negotiated. Whereas in heterosexual relationships, monogamy is assumed. And therefore, what's to talk about? If you talk about it, you are literally tackling the sacred cow.
And I don't think it's necessarily a problem that it's assumed, and it's what most people want. The conversation I think people who are in committed monogamous relationships really do need to have if we want their relationships to survive for the long term is, what will we do if an infidelity should occur? Rather than telling each other it's impossible, it could never happen, when it happens, if it happens, but most likely when you look at the stats, what are we going to do? Let's commit now, before it's happened, while we're still passionately in love, that this will be something we can work through, that the relationship, both of us now, we're going to put our chips in and say, the relationship is more important than sexual exclusivity executed for 50 years without fail. Because we're not naturally monogamous animals. You're asking people to stand on one foot for 50 years and then executing them when they touch the ground once to regain their balance or whatever else they need to do. And you're right that it is easier for two men to negotiate this because power, because of the culture, the zap on women's head. But we should empower women to have this conversation. Women are no more suited for or good at monogamy than men. As women have entered the workforce, as women have become more autonomous and achieved more power, the rates of infidelity, the stats, women are pulling even with men, as likely now to cheat.
It's the one gap they're
men.
Closing.
Not the pay gap, but the fuck gap, definitely closing.
Not really, because they still have 77 orgasms to your 100, so.
My message, well, that's why we have group sex, so we can, like, accumulate them. What I've come to after 25 years of slogging through the mail, and I don't know if you would agree with this after your long career of slogging through the wreckage, is that we can have committed, stable, long-term relationships, or we can have monogamous ones.
All right,
but not
Jenny,
both.
Jenny, I want to bring you into this conversation.
My turn.
Your turn. You're in a funny place because I'm going to read something.
You think?
Yeah. In many ways. I didn't mean that. You're like simultaneously at the edges of the future of marriage and in a long-term committed marriage. I'm going to read something you wrote in your Modern Love piece when I was preparing for this. Several years ago, Jenny wrote a Modern Love piece, which was then read on the Modern Love podcast, the New York Times podcast, so you should either read it or listen to it. It was read beautifully. But she wrote, "In the fall, we picked apples. In the winter, we skied. In the summer, we fished on Long Pond. Most of the time, we forgot there was anything extraordinary about our family, and who knows, maybe there isn't."
Yeah,
now, anybody from
the
outside is...
I'm the experiment and the control.
Huh?
I'm the experiment and the control.
Right. What do you mean?
Well,
talk about that.
So the language for talking about trans stuff is always inexact. So even a phrase like, back when I was a guy, I know that there are trans people... There are people in my community who would hate that phrase, but here we go. So back in the time before, when to all the world, I appeared to be a straight guy. Married my wife then and my wife now. In fact, just a little sidebar. My wife and I celebrated our 28th wedding anniversary last Saturday. 12 years as husband and wife and 16 years as wife and wife. So go figure that out. If she wants to raise her hand and identify herself, she can. Or she might... Oh, there she is. Hey. The bravest woman in America. So back in the day, I guess that's a good way of describing it. Was it a great mystery that I was trans? I ask because sex was never as important to me as being in love. Like, what the thing I always wanted was to be in love. And you know, sex was, you know, my sense was, you know, even when I was in college, when everyone was supposed to be fucking, you know, left and right, you know, I didn't want to have sex unless I was really sure that we were really, really, you're looking at me like, what?
No, I'm just like, oh my God, you were a lesbian the whole time.
Yeah. It was kind of like that. Yeah. So, yeah. I came out as trans, 10 years into the marriage, and believe it or not, more couples, about 50% of couples stay together, and about 50% of the couples break up. Everyone would think that would be a deal breaker, and maybe it's worth asking you if you are with somebody right now, and they told you that they were changing genders. Would that be it? Would that be, oh, sorry, we're done. I love you, honey, but, and I'm not saying it was easy because, you know, we really struggled, Dee Dee and I, and it was pretty miserable, and there were a lot of tears were cried, but in the end, we decided that our lives were together, were better together than apart. So, lo and behold, here we are for the last 16 years, apparently a lesbian couple. And our sex lives have changed, you could say. And yet, in many ways, that piece that you read, I think our lives, the overall truth of our lives and of our relationship is constant. And, you know, we have two sons that they're now in their 20s. And I kind of forget that there's anything different about us a lot of the time. So in that way, in some ways, it's kind of like extraordinary story. And in the other ways, it's like, you know, I might be the most boring person up here, you know, because, you know, I've been in a monogamous relationship for almost 30 years now. And it's kind of all I really ever wanted. Now, having said that, it's worth noting that there are many, many ways of being trans. And, you know, there are cross-dressers, there are drag queens, there are intersex people, there are genderqueer people, there are gender-fluid people, there are good old-fashioned transsexuals, male to female and female to male, and actually a lot of people who don't really have a word for what they are and don't care and kind of resent being, you know, pigeonholed in that way. But sometimes, what's the expression? If you know one trans person, if you've met one trans person, you've met one trans person.
Although, don't people assume things about you, like assume that you're transgressive in other ways? I mean, that's what a trans friend of mine once. So people would come to her and tell her secrets, like assume that she was Dan Savage, and she wanted to hear all of your, you know, transgressions and secrets.
I hear a lot
but
of
she
secrets.
Was like, I'm just going to work. Like, I'm playing Candy Crush. Could you leave me alone, you know?
If I'm doing a book signing or something, I meet a lot of trans people who are like, you know, how do I find the courage? And I'm like, well, don't ask me. Just one foot in front of the other. Try to be known. In some ways, that's the hardest thing in the world. I mean, it's the advice we give everyone. Just be yourself. You know, when in doubt, remember, like, you're going in for a job interview, just be yourself. As if that's so easy. As if, you know, in fact, there is nothing harder in the world than just being yourself. But in any case, talking about transgender people, there are trans people that I know that are highly motivated by sex. They love fucking. They love and being trans is something that's really exciting for them. For some people, the idea of changing genders, either permanently or you know, temporarily or for an afternoon, is itself thrilling. Which is great, right? There's nothing wrong with that. Mm-hmm. The problem is that there's such a wide variety of trans experiences that anything you say about any individual trans person, whether you're talking about their sex lives or anything else, may or may not have anything to do with the next trans person you meet. So it's one reason why I think people struggle with trans stuff and why it's so hard to be an ally, because you know even we haven't gotten our story straight. You know, we're the discourse is still being developed. We're still working on it. It's a work in progress, and it's frustrating.
Mm-hmm. Dan, I asked you a version of this question earlier. Do you see the shame drop away over the 25 years? Since it's now nighttime, I'm going to ask you the reverse of that question. Given sort of advancement in gay rights, in trans acceptance, do you get questions and situations now that you would not have imagined 20 years ago? Like, are people more... Is it reflected in the questions a kind of openness and experimentation? Do you see Americans behaving through your lens, which is a specific lens, differently than they did or you would have imagined?
I do. I see people who feel more entitled to pleasure.
In a good way
in
or
a good
bad way?
In a good way. Not entitled to someone else providing them with pleasure, whether that person is interested in providing with that pleasure or not, but entitled to go seek and ask. What I don't get, and I used to get constantly, and I rarely get this question anymore, is the question where somebody unpacks really a bizarre set of interests or circumstances, and it ends with, is this normal? And that was what they were most worried about. And I really feel that the triumph of the LGBT civil rights movement has changed the attitudes of a lot of straight people.
Do you just mean that sentence has dropped out of the question?
That sentence has dropped out of the question.
They just ask you, but they don't say, is this normal?
They're not unpacking this crazy thing they want to do and then wondering what that means about them. They're unpacking this crazy thing to do and wondering how to make it happen and how to achieve it in a way that's consensual and healthy and non-destructive. And I really think that gay people and queer people, we deserve the credit for having changed straight people, because
absolutely.
And you can clap. You can give it to him.
And the right wing Christian fundamentalists of 50, 40 years ago saw this coming. They saw the way gay people lived and said, this is a threat to heteronormativity, although they didn't use that word then, because look at these people having multiple partners, living in urban areas, not committing, not settling down, not having children. Some of us wanted to, we weren't allowed to, but not all of us wanted to. And what straight people saw, if they ever saw a gay pride parade go by, was they saw there were so many different ways to be gay, or lesbian, or bi, or trans. And they asked themselves, I think many subconsciously, why is there just one way to be straight?
Right. Esther, in your practice, this increased appetite for variety in sex, for, you know, acceptance of sex, how does it show up in the context of a couple?
So I've been a couples therapist for 30-something years. You may be surprised to know, but most couples therapists have never gotten 1 hour of training about sexuality. It's a completely desexualized practice. And the tautology always was that if there are sexual problems, it must mean that there are relationship problems. Hence, you fix the relationship, you bring back the complicity, the teamwork, the understanding, the communication, the intimacy, and the sex will follow. And therefore, you never have to talk about sex. And that was quite comfortable and convenient, and I was trained like that for many, many years. Except that I began to see that people got along much better, they liked each other again, they wanted to stay together, but it actually changed absolutely nothing in the bedroom. The kitchen got better, but not the other rooms. And that's when I began to think about the book Mating in Captivity, you know. What was it like that so many people would come in and say, we love each other very much, we have no sex? Because to write a book about people who don't like each other and don't want to touch each other or be with each other, that's kind of boring and redundant. So I thought, you know, here is a very interesting thing. Love and desire, they relate and they also conflict. And herein lies the mystery of eroticism. And so 30 years ago, I can't remember people coming into my office because neither for infidelity, by the way, they certainly did not come for infidelity, and they didn't come for many sexual questions except questions of sexual functioning and sexual dysfunction. And all of the sex therapy field was about performance and function and dysfunction. Today, most people who come to see a sex therapist come with questions of desire. Wanting and the lack of wanting and wanting to want and having wanted and not wanting anymore or wanting plenty but not with the person you're supposed to want it with. You know, those kind of things. And that's a tremendous, tremendous change. The idea that marital happiness would be linked with sexual satisfaction is a completely new norm. The idea that people would stay in my office and say, this is the classic presenting problem. We love each other. We have a great relationship. We have been together for 20-something years. We have everything that Dan described, family, children sometimes, extended community, etc., etc. We haven't been physical with each other, and I'm not just talking about having sex, fucking that. Just physical with each other in a kind of touch that isn't just family affectionate touch, but a touch of an adult intimacy in 2, 5, 7, 12 years. And then the question becomes, how important is sex? Do you dismantle this whole relationship because it doesn't have this? Or do you rethink the importance of this dimension of one's life? And that's the question.
I often find my theory or stuff I pulled out of my ass about all this is that it's often boredom that kills desire. And if your partner standing before you is the reason you can't experience anything new, whether with your partner or with somebody else, because people stop trying, then they de-eroticize themselves. You de-eroticize the relationship. There's a lot of Lori Brodo and others, Meredith Chavers, these people who are working on hyposexual desire in women, which is low to no sexual desire in women, and you have these pharmaceutical companies trying to come up with female Viagra, which is complete bullshit, because Viagra is not there to instill desire. It's there to bring an erection to somebody who's already horny. And the female Viagra they're talking about is, how do you treat these women who have no desire for sex? And
with the sex they can have, that doesn't mean they have no desire for sex.
But the thing I want to cite,
the same woman who is totally shut up here and closed up here is the one who is having the most luscious
reading 50 Shades of Grey
and affair.
But this is what I find so interesting, and it keeps coming up when I talk to Lori Brodo, Meredith Chavers, and others who are looking into this. They work with these women. They go to psychologists. They go to couples counselors. They medicate them. They tell them to drink wine and just do it. And their marriages are on the line, and they don't want to get divorced, and they're distraught, and they're just sexually dead and broken, and nothing can be done. And finally they get divorced, and suddenly she's horny. It all comes back because she can fuck somebody else. And what does that tell us about the problem at the heart of a lot of sexless marriages? And I'm not saying that everybody has to be in an open relationship, but if we could just acknowledge that, one of the things that could do more to bring peace to people's relationships is to stop policing each other for evidence of what we should just assume is true. Of course you want to fuck other people. Of course I want to fuck other people. So I don't care. If you looked at porn, I'm not going to have a meltdown because, it means you want to fuck other people. You flirted with somebody or whatever. Of course you do.
Jenny,
I do too.
Help me out here. Help me out with the complicated scenario that these guys are painting as the best one.
No,
it's just
I am
too
not
complicated.
Aligned with him. You keep saying these guys.
You know, I feel like the
We're
message
the scary
here
ones.
Is like if you don't buy into the polyamorous future, you're just a loser.
You don't have to buy into the polyamorous future. You have to let go of the lie that being in love means you do not desire anyone else, and that a monogamous commitment is easy to make if there is love. Because what then people do who are not who haven't thought about it and aren't very bright is they experience desire for someone else and think, I must not love my husband anymore.
Did you say not very bright?
Yes, I did. Or they say, my partner is attracted to someone else, therefore they must not love me anymore. And that tears at commitments, that tears at relationships. We should all acknowledge that we'd be more capable of successfully being monogamous over the long term if we just acknowledge that it's hard and it's at war with our human animal natures. And that if somebody was monogamous to you for 50 years and only fucked somebody else once, they were really good at monogamy, not bad at it.
There you have it.
There you have it, exactly. Okay, we're going to switch gears a little bit here before we take your questions. I'm going to have one of these people, whoever has one in their head, present a scenario, either a question that's come to them or a situation they faced in the office, And then the rest of us are going to sort of intervention that situation. If you've seen the show Intervention, we're going to say what we would have said to that scenario. So yours is easiest because you just get questions. So give us a question, and I want to hear these guys
Can
say
I roll it out
what
in,
advice they would give.
I'm going to roll it out in two parts.
Okay.
Question from two sons, two young adult males, who discovered that their mother has been cheating on their father for 5 years, and what should they do about it?
So they're asking, like, should I tell the father? What should they do? Okay, who wants to take it?
let me make sure I have this right. The sons are how old?
Young adults, over 18. I can't remember their exact ages, but they were like college age, discovered mom had been having an affair for 5 years. Also both furious at their mother and want to know what to do about it.
Where?
What? Dad does not know.
Okay. Well, where do you begin to unpack that? Do we begin with being mad at mom for not being the perfect mom? Do we begin with a conversation with Dan? That's a tough one. I'm glad I don't have your job.
Wait till
Esther,
I tell you the second part of the question.
Yes. Wait, let Esther give it a try, because they came to her office and they say we're
no,
so
No, they
pissed.
Don't just come to my office. I've received 1,300 letters since the TED Talk alone. So I actually have written this very story, but not from two men, but from two women, in my upcoming book. And it was a fascinating distinction because there was also a major cultural difference about it. So I'm gonna answer it to you and explain to you why the cultural difference matters so much. In case number one, and then I'll answer you boys. In case number one, the girl basically knows that mom has a secret phone and dad is asking for the phone, and at one point she holds the phone and she throws it to dad with all the information so that he would know and so that the truth could come out. And this is the American version of the importance of the truth, the importance of transparency for trust, and the importance of laying down the facts. Woman number two, she is in her 20s. She's dad asks her to find an address. She goes into his phone, and in the phone she finds the name of someone that's the secretary, which dad has been with, and she now puts one and one and one together for probably about 15 years. Or longer, and mom doesn't know, and she decides this was an arranged marriage. She's Indian, but a great relationship, a father of the family, an upstanding man in the community, a mother who probably has been very happy to be left alone for a long time, and she says, why will I destroy the entire family? Why would that part about him become the determining fact? Meanwhile, mom needs surgery. Dad's been with her for the whole week in all the treatments. The man is a devoted husband who also loves another woman. One of the places we are apart is that when you present it, it's the emphasis is intensely on the sex. The mother has been fucking somebody for 5 years. I don't think of it like that. I think that, first of all, sex is actually not necessarily the most important part of most affairs. It is much more about what I call desire, but desire for what? Desire to be important, desire to be special again, desire not to just be a function in the house, desire to have someone who thinks about you and who is interested in you as a person. It's desire for playfulness, desire to feel young again and not old. It's a lot of things that people experience when they describe the word that is used all over the world about having an affair, which is that they feel alive. That's the one word you will hear across the globe, which is part of what I do. So these two men, when they write to me, I go like this. So I don't know how you found out. Maybe you do. Do you know how they found out? How?
They read mom's emails.
Okay.
And dad wasn't online.
Right. So I understand that you're asking me, I don't know if you're asking me, if you should confront your mother, if you should rethink who your mother is, if it changes your entire experience of who she was, it's like coming out in a straight family. Or if your dad deserves to know, and what would be the consequences of his knowing? Or and all these questions at this point may preoccupy you deeply. And the first thing I'm going to say to you is at this point, you have to take absolutely no action. You have to let this thing sink in to you. And if you want, maybe you want to ask your mom. You may want to say, Mom, I realize that there is a part of your life that I didn't know. And I don't know if it's my right to ask you about it because you're not entitled to enter her privacy just like that. But it makes me rethink our entire family. Tell me, what do I need to know about this? And then ask not for the facts, ask for the meaning. There's two kinds of questions, I would say. There are detective questions that mine the sordid details, and then there are the investigative questions that actually ask about the meaning of this, because you may find out that you actually don't know the relationship between your parents one bit. And you have no idea what's been going on behind the doors and what this man has done and what have been other betrayals and to what extent this affair that your mother has had actually has allowed her to stay in the marriage with your father and to be there for you as the mother that wakes up with you every morning.
Okay.
Is that what you said?
I said it was a trick question because I didn't give part of the letter.
That's just the beginning, by the way.
Dad... You totally nailed it. Dad was, they included in this letter, furious at mom, two boys raised by this man and this woman, furious at mom, feeling like they must go to dad, really, really angry at mom. And then dad is emotionally abusive, a tyrant, was always aggressive with their mother. Their mother was miserable throughout this marriage, stayed with him for the kids. He's now not in good health and she is staying with him and helping him. But they just can't get, they're so attached to that idea that in an infidelity is the ultimate betrayal and turns everything past into a lie. And my response to them was, obviously you were raised by your father because you are patriarchal little tyrannical shits yourselves. And why can't you
I never answer like that.
I would. And if there's anything that you should be feeling right now for your mother, it's joy. You should feel happy for her that she found some comfort and some pleasure and some affirmation and some love and some support in someone's arms because she never got it by your own description, never once got it from her awful husband. Shut your fucking mouths. And I would say never tell mom. I'm more brutal sometimes than you would be. And be happy for your mother.
Like,
my answer was be happy for your mother. And so, don't be your father's sons, be your mother's sons.
But I think that...
I think I am the outlier here. Now that I've had a chance to think about this, I don't do what you guys do, but what I do know is that secrets can be toxic, and as someone who spent nearly 40 years of her life carrying a giant secret, I mean, the biggest difference between who I was back in the day and now, it's not the difference between male and female. It's the difference between having a secret and not having a secret.
I totally agree with you, but sometimes a truth can be explosive and you have to look at what telling some truth will explode.
Well, and these are 13-year-old boys, and so the question is, at what point is truth going to set
them? These are college age.
But you're privileging one secret above another.
And when is truth going to be... in a way, you're asking them now to shoulder a secret. You know, and... So on principle, I want to say it is always better to air the truth.
But Jennifer, you do privilege one truth above another. You know, relational betrayals come in many forms. Indifference, contempt, neglect, violence are relational betrayals that often live in secret in the house as well. But in our society, there is a hegemony that says that infidelity is the ultimate betrayal. Why is this secret worse than what this man may have done for the 30 or the 18 years preceding?
Well, they should know that too. And in fact, I would not put... infidelity over those.
Then
those truths are much more important.
Good.
And and they should know that.
But I just
so
like
then we good.
Like
yeah.
The yeah, okay. I think we covered that.
Yeah. Okay. I actually these questions are really good, so I feel like I want to skip. How much time do we have?
All the time.
Huh?
All the time.
Can someone ask Blues Traveler to come on later?
Okay, listen, so we're not going to go to the next one, huh?
How much time do we have?
Not very much. So I want to go to these questions because they're excellent, okay? So anyone can answer this. There's a few of these I really want to answer, okay? Number one, I have been celibate for 8 years. How do I share this with my next date without terrifying them? Don't laugh. Just kidding. But that's a hard one.
Just tell them you left the priesthood recently. Like, always the truth. Always the truth. I'm going to be down on always the truth.
I mean, how to tell them? You tell them, but, the truth is...
You could say, at least I'm not a virgin.
If the truth were so easy to tell, it would be more popular.
But this is the kind of truth that if you think of it differently, it is easy to tell, because when you tell someone something like that about you, you're telling them one thing about you, their reaction tells you everything you need to know about them.
Right. Yeah.
Because if you say, I haven't had sex with somebody for 7 years because I've been celibate for whatever reason, and they freak out and they don't know what to do and they have a meltdown, that is not the person you want to start having sex with again. And you're well rid of them.
But you want a person who's curious about that, right? You want a person who is asking you why the same, no.
Why would you say something like this? You are entitled to a privacy, and maybe afterwards, in a moment when you feel more trusting and more comfortable, you just say, it's been a long time, and that's it. this kind of unvarnished directness. Like, why? Why not have some mystery, some opaqueness? Not everything has to be laid out on the first date.
As long as we're staying on the question of truth, let's say a man and a woman, and they're on a date and they're going to sleep together. They sleep together. At what point should that woman allow us how she's transgender and she was born male? Before they have sex? Someone's like, oh yes, of course, it's obvious. Of course you would. Well, maybe it's not so obvious. Maybe, I don't know. What do you think, experts?
I think... I have a dodge. It's a slight dodge. I think that it is in the transgender person's own best interest to disclose that, to protect themselves from violence. So many particularly trans women, have been done to death by people who discovered after they were intimate that they were trans, and people have had completely unhinged, irrational, violent reactions to that news that I don't think they have a right to have. But still, I don't want, because it ought to be okay, advise trans women to take that risk, particularly trans women to take that risk.
Yeah.
I agree. I think that it's not the same question. And I think this is no sexual experience exists outside of a larger context. Privacy is always, intersecting with a whole reality. And if I know, I don't arrive to the first time here thinking, will this person accept me, shame me, attack me? I will do what I need to do to feel safe. And so I agree with
but
that.
But you did say people are entitled to their privacy.
Yes, I think that too. But I don't think that in the first situation, the first situation is a private situation in which a person has not had an experience with somebody else. They may have had a lot of sex with themselves. That doesn't mean they have not been sexual. They've not had partner sex, and it's been a long time, and maybe they're feeling a little self-conscious, and maybe they've lost habit, and maybe they just want to share that. And I think, there is no flat answer for this. I do think that the notion that blurting out truth, and that truth is in and of itself a sign of connection, intimacy, trust, and all of that, I think that there is no moral cure around truth, but I think that when truth becomes a protection, it is absolutely vital.
And far be it for me to tell you to say this to you, but
we'll get a box later.
We're only going to get through one more. There's so many good questions.
No, ask them first.
Okay. My husband's sex drive is huge, even though he's 68. He takes Viagra. He's ready to rock. Me, not so much. I'd rather read. He wants to please me. What should I do?
Outsource.
Next question.
This comes up. My partner wants to do this thing I don't want to do. In all cases but sex, you're like, go do that with somebody else. Go. I don't like to bowl. Go fucking bowl. I don't like to mountain bike. You go mountain bike.
Okay.
But when it comes to this, it's like, you like, only you can do this with me. And you want to do it and I don't. So you're either going to be deprived and angry and resentful, or I'm going to go through the motions and be angry and resentful. Outsource.
Okay. So... Rapid fire.
I'm glad I have this beer.
Rapid fire. I think that I would ask this person this. Tip, I turn myself off when? I shut myself off by. And now start giving the list. Typically, people will say, what turns me off is, and he turns me off when? Ask yourself how you extinguish yourself, how you just close it off.
There's some people and who are just done with sex, though. They're just
but
like
it's not sex. It's also sensuality. It's touch. It's pleasure. It's a lot of other things. Sex isn't just something you do. It's a place you go inside yourself and with another or others, in which you connect with multiple parts of yourself. It's a language. So I am curious to understand when this woman says to me, assuming this is a woman, that she says, but I could ask the same question to a man, how do you shut yourself off and how do you turn yourself on? Desire is to own the one thing. So how do you awaken yourself? And the answers generally have nothing to do with sex per se. They will have to do with feeling good about oneself, one's own body, about music, about nature, about intimate conversations, about confidence, about age, things like that. And then you start to, because otherwise you're going to give a lot of advice to this man, and basically, if there is nobody at the reception desk, the hotel is closed.
Can we do one more? Okay, they said we can do one more. Clock says 60 seconds. What's the best way to kick a porn addiction?
Why would you have to?
Define addicted.
Find porn. I feel like this is like a philosophical round.
You know, Dr. David Leahy does a lot of writing about porn and sex addiction and all these tropes. Points out that you never hear people talking about gay men and their porn addictions. That porn addiction is something that only seems to afflict straight men, despite the fact that gay men consume porn at the same rate or higher rates than straight men. So what is the difference there between straight men and gay men? Well, religion and being in relationships with women is suddenly where porn becomes a much larger problem. So porn is a problem if you're neglectful as a result of it, if it's the focus of all your sexual energies. But if someone is choosing porn over you all the time, or you're choosing porn over your partner all the time, probably with the wrong person, probably with the wrong partner, and there's a problem in the relationship. Porn isn't dick kryptonite or relationship kryptonite. The relationship died, and then there was porn.
You know, I've read painful testimonies, though, from men who are not necessarily in a relationship who have said that the ubiquity and availability of porn has made it difficult for them to
push away from the buffet.
Shit.
Right?
I need help.
They're consuming too much of it. They're the person at the buffet who's piling it up on their plate.
To kind of relate to the ordinariness of the human.
Well, we need education about porn that encourages people to, that lets people know that porn can create unrealistic expectations. Porn ain't sex. We need sex education that's porn inclusive because of its ubiquity. Mm-hmm. But again, you know, that's a genie that's not going back in the bottle. Because some people have a problem with it, because some people can't push away from the buffet, which is their problem, not porn's problem, because it creates unrealistic expectations. And some people, okay, so we should not have porn? How are you going to do that? How are we going to stop it?
But the question was not if you should or should not have porn. The question is about a person who feels that they're...
You and your feelings. It's always feelings.
You with your fucking.
I feel pretty good when I'm fucking.
So. I like to watch.
I think that, you know, before you try to think of it as kicking an addiction, and yes, we can have a whole conversation about Does it even exist, the porn addiction? What is porn? There's a long, very, very important conversation that needs to take place at this point around this. But there's a few things that porn does to you, male consumer, that's different from the female consumer, that I think I would start the conversation with. Porn takes care of three of the most important male vulnerabilities in sex. You never reject it, because she never says, no, I have a headache. She just says, me too, more, more, more. You're never made to feel like you're a dirty little boy who's greedy, because she too. You're never made to feel inadequate, because she's always coming, and more than once, and she screams about it. And you don't have to do much. So your inadequacy, your performance fear, and you never have to wonder if she's liking it or not, and what is the mystery of the female pleasure, because she lets you know that she's coming and she's having a lot of pleasure. So you have solved three of the most important vulnerabilities related to male sexuality. And I would start a conversation with you about that.
One more question.
Have you ever been in such an evening?
This is Occupy
Aspen. The raunchy
Aspen.
One or the sociological one? All right. They're not that raunchy. This is Aspen Idea. So a lot of them are like highbrow sex.
Good,
so, you know. What can be done about guys that will not go down on you? What did you say?
Oral comes standard in any model that arrives without oral should be returned immediately.
All right, you want me to read a few more?
Because I think...
Here's the deal. I'm going to read a few, and then these guys can
choose. Give just such a sense of what...
Do you think the perceived sexual disempowerment of men that could be seen as the consequence of the sexual empowerment of women contributed in any way to our current political situation? Political situation.
I'm sorry. I just dozed off for a second.
I'd like a raunchy question, please.
Actually, it says... contributed to Brexit.
Or to porn.
Okay.
We're question shaming someone, and I feel guilty about it.
Intellectual shaming is totally respectable, just not sexual shaming. What's the balance when starting a relationship where both people agree with open relationships and want to create a foundation of a real partnership? Where's the line?
Keep going.
Okay, keep going.
I think it's a nice...
I really wanted to answer.
That is a brave woman.
It's so. Entire... We have so little time left. Don't clap. It eats up time. It's entirely anecdotal, but in my vast observations of people in open relationships, it tends to be the ones that are effortlessly... if not formally closed for a very long time, that are the successful open relationships in the long run. If within a week you're both effing other people and making time to eff other people, and I'm not talking about polyamory, which is a different model, those don't, in my experience, last. But relationships where there was 2, 3, 4 years of closed without it being nailed shut, just this is what we want, and then there was a conversation about openness, a conversation about others, and some tiptoeing out, that was mutually agreeable. That's the model that I see typically works.
I agree.
Me too.
Why did you start bleeping yourself all of a sudden?
Did I bleep myself?
Yes. Effing.
Oh, sorry about that.
Fucking.
There we go.
What is the biggest sexual turn on for females, also known as women?
Confidence. Confidence is the biggest turn on in every gender and across the globe.
You mean what men like confident women, women like confident men?
Ask yourself, when am I most drawn to my partner? Not just sexually attracted, most drawn to my partner. And you will see that in all of you, one of the answers will be when they're in their element, when they're confident, when they're on stage, when they're on their horse, when they're on whatever it is they're doing. On the sailing, you know, when they're doing something in their studio, when they're in their element, i.e. when they're self-sufficient, confident, and you experience the sense of otherness.
It's never when you're sitting across from each other in a fancy restaurant having a romantic meal.
Except in the beginning.
I'm never more attracted to my husband than when he's snowboarding, which is ridiculous because it's impossible to actually. Like, I see, we're snowboarding. I'm like, I want to fuck you so bad right now.
Yeah, just
you have all this snowboarding gear on.
More snow suits.
The reason
snow
the
confidence.
There's zips everywhere, just not where you need one.
Yeah, exactly.
No, but Dan, the reason the confidence is so important is because when that person wants you, you know that they want you, not that they need you. When they need you, you can be perfectly caring and responsive, but caring and caretaking is often a mighty anti-aphrodisiac. When they're confident and they want you, you know that you're in the realm of desire.
And one of the things that's in mating and captivity that's so great that Esther points out is that you're often more attracted to your partner when you see someone else being attracted to them. Doesn't mean you have to have an open relationship, but you're out in public, somebody is basking in your partner's glow, and you suddenly look at them through that other person's eyes, and they are that much more attractive to you, or your attraction to them is renewed.
I feel like the men in the audience are Googling, where can I rent a horse right now? Okay. All right, well, Esther, Dan, Jenny, you've been amazing. You've been a great audience. Thank you so much.